Hello everybody, I'm Theo Hartzell, and today I want to talk to you about the Greek word logos. And what does that Greek word logos even mean? Now, I've already made another video about the difference between logos and rhema, and so if you want to know what the rhema word is and what that specifically means, then you can go watch that video. But in this video, I want to talk about the Greek word logos, specifically how it talks in John chapter 1, verse 1. It says, "In the beginning was the word, logos." And the word logos was with God, and then the logos was God. What does that mean? Now we're going to dig into it and we're going to look at and analyze what exactly does this Greek word logos even mean. And I believe that you're going to receive a divine revelation from God, because I'm going to show you that you may have been looking at logos in the totally wrong way, not realizing all the fullness and all the implications of what the biblical author and God Almighty were trying to tell us when it says, "In the beginning was the Logos, and the Logos was with God, and the Logos was God." Does that mean that Jesus Christ had a body in the very beginning? How does that work out with the virgin birth and then the body was born? Is Jesus Christ part of a trinity and there's three people sitting around the throne? There's God the Father on the throne and there's a Holy Spirit on one side and Jesus on the other side? Is Jesus Christ existing as a separate spirit apart from and separate from Father God and separate from the Holy Spirit? I've got great news for you. We're going to dig into this and analyze this, and I believe you're going to receive a divine revelation from the Lord God Almighty, because I'm going to show you what the Greek word logos specifically means, and by the time we're done, you're going to have a deeper and fuller understanding and revelation that Jesus Christ is none other than, biblically and scripturally, what it says, Jesus Christ is none other than Yahweh God Himself manifested in a body. Stick with me, and I'll be right back. One thing that I'll say right off the bat is there is many, many, many scriptures that I would love to talk about, but for the sake of time, I cannot put them all in this video. What I'm going to try to do in this video is I'm going to try to focus on the Greek word logos and how it specifically implies and talks about, enforces, and relates to Jesus Christ being Yahweh God Himself manifested in a human body. Now, I'm asking you to stick with me, because I am going to have a lot of verses that I'm going to bring in, and this is going to answer a lot of questions that you've had. And I'm telling you, I promise you, if you will stick with me and if you will pray for God to open your heart, you will have a deep and a good understanding and revelation of what this scripture passage is trying to say, and a deeper understanding of who God actually is. So with that being said, let me just say a very quick prayer over us before we even start. God, I'm asking you to give us divine revelation and understanding. I'm asking you, every single person that's watching this or listening to this, Lord, I'm asking that you would open their heart, open their mind, open their spirit, open their revelation, give them eyes to see, give them ears to hear, and a heart to understand. God, let the soil of their heart be receptive to the seed of your word and the revelation of your understanding, God. Lord, I'm asking you to move right now for every single one of us, God. Let every single one of us receive impartation and understanding of what you want to do in our life, and let us know, God, what are you trying to say? And we want to know who you are, and we are trying to understand who you are. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Thank you for letting me pray. Now let's just jump into the scripture text and look at it and study what is the Lord trying to tell us. It says in John chapter 1, verse 1, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." Word in the Greek right there is the Greek word 3056, logos. Now I want you to listen to me very carefully, and I'm going to go very slow, because you absolutely have to get right off the bat what I'm telling you. I'm going to define what the Greek word logos means according to the Greek dictionaries. But you're going to have to get this, because this is going to be the hinge pin, or the important thing that the whole study hangs on, because many people have a misunderstanding and misinterpretation of what logos means, because they think that logos simply means a word after the word has been spoken or written down or recorded or manifested and do not know or realize that logos actually also means the word before it comes out of the mouth or before it comes through a manifestation of a song or a play or anything else. In other words, it is the thought or an idea or a plan in the mind of the individual who has it before it ever manifests out of their mouth or before it ever manifests in whatever else they're going to do, whether they're building a boat or building a house or engineering a big building or a structure or sculpting something or writing a play or writing a song or writing a poem or whatever it is. Listen to this. Vine's Expository Dictionary says that the Greek word logos means the expression of thought, not the mere name of an object, as embodying a concept or an idea. Did you hear that? It is saying that the word logos is not just the thought or the word or the name of an object, but the word logos actually means also the concept or the idea of where it came from. This is so important. Listen to what the Thayer Greek Dictionary says. It says that logos means a word uttered by a living voice, embodies a concept or idea. Did you hear me? It says it embodies a concept or idea. Going on, of speech, a word uttered by a living voice embodies a conception or idea. There it is again. It is reinforcing and stating that the word logos is not just the word coming out of a person's mouth, but it actually embodies the very concept, idea, thought, or plan of where the word originated from in the first place. According to Strong's Greek Dictionary, it means something said by implication, a topic, reason, or motive, or computation, and intent. It is saying the exact same thing, that logos does not just include the word as it's spoken, which is the end result of the word or the manifestation of it, but also the beginning of the word when it is in the thought process or the idea or the concept or the plan. According to the Word Study Dictionary, logos means to speak intelligently, expression of intelligence, discourse, saying, thing. According to Robinson's Word Picture, it says logos is common for reason as well as for speech. And that is enforcing and telling you exactly what logos is. Logos, a word logos, is not just talking about speech. It is also talking about the reason or the thought or the idea or the concept or the plan of where the word originated and came from. In other words, it's not just a word coming out of your mouth, but it's what's going on in your mind. It is your reasoning. According to the Vincent Word Study, it says this, logos is first of all a collecting or collection both of things in the mind and of words by which they are expressed. Did you hear that? In other words, the logos word is not just the expressed word, but it's the word at the very beginning when it is still in the mind. This is so incredible. Going on, it therefore signifies both the outward form by which the inward thought is expressed and the inward thought itself. Listen to this. It also says that logos is a word as embodying a conception or idea, the exact same thing that the other Greek dictionary said. What all of this is saying is that many people have misinterpreted the Greek word logos because they think only about logos in the form of like it's manifested or it's happened or it's come to manifest. It's taken place. It's done. It's finished. It's been spoken. It's been recorded. It's been manifested by hands, by power, by whatever it was, and it's completed and done. But according to the Greek dictionaries, and you can study this out yourself, but according to the Greek dictionaries, and if you'll study it out, it is saying that the Greek word logos is not only the word that is spoken or manifested, but logos also includes the word in a person's mind as a thought or an idea or a plan or a concept, because before the word was ever manifested, before the word was ever made plain, before the word was ever spoken or manifested through a sculpture, a sonnet, a poem, a song, a playwright, however the word manifests and comes out. Before it ever had that physical manifestation, it was in the mind of the person who had the origination of the thought, idea, plan, or concept in their mind, and therefore the word existed in the mind of the person before it was physically manifested. And I feel the power of God on me so strong because I'm trying not to get wound up, but this is so powerful because this shows the revelation and the power and the beauty in the mind of God. And this helps us to understand John chapter 1. In the beginning was the plan, and the plan was with God, and the plan was God. Why? Because God didn't do a single thing without the plan in mind. And I'm getting ahead of all my scriptures, but please bear with me. He didn't do a single thing without His plan in mind, because He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the beginning and the ending. And I want you to know, before He started one thing in the very beginning, He already had it all worked out at the very ending. He had it written down because He's not in time. He's outside of time. And He knew exactly what He was going to do. And the manifestation of everything that He's done has been with the plan in mind, because Logos is not just the expression of it, but it's the thought or the idea in the mind before He ever started. In Jesus' name. Amen. I didn't mean to get emotional right there, but I get very emotional with the revelation of God because I think it's incredibly beautiful. And I think that if people don't have a proper understanding of the revelation of one God, and Jesus Christ is none other than Yahweh God manifested in flesh, then they're not giving God the proper and true glory, because God's the one who wrote it from the end to the beginning. He knew everything that was going to happen. Jesus Christ is the image of the invisible God. I'm getting ahead of myself again, but Jesus is the image of the invisible God, because no man can see God at any time. No man's ever seen Him. No man can see Him and live. But when the fullness of time was come, God manifested Himself in a human body. And that when you see Jesus Christ, you see none other than Yahweh God Himself. And that's why I think this is so beautiful. I'll bring all of those scriptures in a minute. I just kind of gave you a little shotgun effect right there, but let's get back into the Bible study. Now, the reason that I said that, for example, is because I want you to fully grasp and understand that before the word is manifested, the word also existed as the thought or the idea or the plan or the concept in the mind of the individual who the Logos existed with. For example, we can look at and analyze the song Amazing Grace. I'm not going to sing that for you. Most everybody probably knows the song Amazing Grace. But before that song was written down on paper, some of those words began to come to the person who wrote the song, and then they began to write them down. It went from a transition of the beginning of the Logos to a written Logos on a piece of paper. But nonetheless, it is a Logos in its inception, thought, idea, or plan, and then it is manifested on a piece of paper. For example, we could also look at many people who create all kinds of sculptures and buildings and engineer and design houses and buildings and all kinds of things, and all these people who have created all these marvelous, wonderful things in our world, and all of those things started somewhere in the mind of the individual and person before it manifested in the flesh, whether it was a drawing or a painting or a sonnet or a poem or whatever the manifestation of it was, a building, a car, an airplane. So however that manifestation comes, it is still the origination of the idea as the Logos, Word of God, in the mind. Now, the reason this is important and the reason this is beautiful is because this is going to tie in so beautifully to John chapter 1. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through the passage in John chapter 1, and I'm going to read it. Now, what I'm going to do is not going to harm the scripture in any way, but let me explain to you what I'm going to do. I'm going to take the English word out, and I'm going to move it out of the scripture passage, and I'm going to take the definition, the word plan, and I'm going to put it in its place. And so I'm going to read it instead of saying word or speaking about the word, and I'm going to put the word plan in there to show you that the word logos actually means the idea, the concept, or the plan as it is existing before it actually manifests. The reason I'm going to do this is because this is going to be so important, and it's going to give you a revelation about what the Apostle John was trying to tell you about the revelation that Jesus Christ was none other than Yahweh God of the Old Testament living in a human body. But now stick with me as I just read John chapter 1, doing what I told you I'm going to do, and you'll get an understanding of what I'm saying as I go through this. So listen to this. In the beginning was the plan, and the plan was with God, and the plan was God. Now I'm doing this again, and I just feel the Spirit of God on me so strong just even doing this, because I already told you that that word for logos right there is a thought or an idea or a plan in the mind of the individual who had it before it ever manifested in its manifestation or expression. Let me read it again. In the beginning was the plan, and the plan was with God, and the plan was God. The plan was in the beginning with God. All things were made by the plan, and without the plan was not anything made that was made. Did you hear it? All things were made by the plan, and without the plan was not anything made that was made. That's going to be so important in a minute. Verse 4, in the plan was life, and the life was the light of men, and the plan shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehendeth it not. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same, that's speaking about John, the same came for a witness to bear witness of the plan that all men through him might believe. He, speaking about John was not the plan, but was sent to bear witness of the plan. That was the true light which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. The plan was in the world, and the world was made by the plan, and the world knew not the plan. The plan came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received the plan, to them the plan gave power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on the plan's name. Did you hear that? The plan gives people the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on the plan's name. That means the plan has a name. What's that name? That name is Jesus. We're going to see that in a minute. Verse 13, which was born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. And the plan was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld the plan's glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Verse 15, John bare witness of the plan and cried, saying, this was the plan of whom I spake. The plan that cometh after me is preferred before me, for the plan was before me. Did you hear that? The Logos was before John. And the plan's fullness have we all received, and grace for grace, for the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by the plan, which is none other than Jesus Christ, but grace and truth came by the plan. No man has seen God at any time. The plan, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared him. Now, I don't know if you've ever done an exercise like that where you take the definitions and put it back into the scripture context, but if you will do that, you will begin to have revelation and understanding that maybe you've never had in your life before, because you're simply looking at the English word translated that the translators chose to put in there. But if you'll look at the Greek and the Hebrew to understand, okay, what was the meaning of this word? Now, putting it all in context, what is the author trying to say? And so that's why I chose to read it like that. Now, if you want to go back and reread it again in the King James and put all of those other words back in there, at least you have an understanding of what the scripture passage was trying to say. Because when you're talking about the word logos, you're not just talking about the expressed or the manifested word. You're talking about the word all the way back to its origination in the mind of the person who had it. So although it may not be manifested at a certain time, it's always in the mind of the person who had the thought or the idea or the concept or the plan in the first place. That's very, very important to make sure that we're all still on the same page. What I'm trying to let you know is that when the Bible says in the beginning was the Logos, and the Logos was with God, and the Logos was God. Or can I say it like this? In the beginning was the plan, and the plan was with God, and the plan was God. The reason I'm saying that is because when God made the very first thing, he made it with this plan of salvation of Jesus Christ in mind, and nothing was made that was ever made. Not a single thing was ever made without the plan of salvation being through Jesus Christ in mind. And so the reason I'm even saying that is because I want you to know and understand when the Logos manifested is none other than God Almighty manifested in a human body that was named Jesus, the Anointed One, or Jesus the Christ, but it's none other than Yahweh God of Israel from the Old Testament, because in the beginning was the thought or the idea or the concept or the plan in his mind before he ever started. And then when the plan manifested, it was none other than Yahweh God himself. And I'm going to show you, so let's just get back into the scripture text, and now we're going to walk in it in a deeper level. Looking at John chapter 1, verse 1 again. In the beginning was the plan, and the plan was with God, and the plan was God. Now, one of the first things that I want to highlight, because this is going to be very, very important. In that phrase, in the beginning was the plan. Was right there is the Greek word 2258, ein, which according to Vine's Expository Dictionary means to be, in the sense that it's already there and already existing. In other words, the thought, idea, concept, or plan was in the mind of God in the beginning before he ever created the first thing, before he ever started. Everything that he did was with the plan in mind. And this word was right here is the Greek word ein, which means that it's already there and it's already existing. The reason I'm saying that is because this word was here with the idea that it's already there and already existing is different than the word in verse 14 for was. In verse 14 it says, and the word, or the plan, and the plan was made flesh and dwelt among us. That phrase right there, was made, those two words are actually one Greek word. It is the Greek word G1096 genomai, which means to begin to be, to come into existence or into any state. In other words, it is opposite from and different from the Greek word 2258 we looked at, ein, in verse 1, which says that it was already there or already there to be in the beginning. And then in verse 14, when you get there, it says that the plan was made flesh or came into being. In other words, the flesh did not exist before, but now the flesh has a beginning or a coming into being, or now it comes into existence. Why is that so important? Because tying it back into John chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning was the plan, and the plan was with God, and the plan was God. Therefore, when the Logos becomes manifested in a human body, in the human flesh suit that they call Jesus, it is none other than what the Bible exactly said, that the Holy Spirit overshadowed the Virgin Mary, and she had a child, and that child was named Jesus, but it's none other than Yahweh, Jehovah God of Israel from the Old Testament, living in a human body so that he can go to the cross sinless on our behalf. And watch how beautiful this is, because this ties into Colossians chapter 1 verse 15, which says who, and this is speaking about Jesus, it says who, and so I'm just going to put Jesus in there, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. In other words, Colossians 1:15 is saying Jesus is none other than the image of the invisible God. Who's the invisible God? The invisible God that nobody's ever been able to look upon and never been able to see is Yahweh God of the Old Testament. Therefore, he made himself a human body to dwell in it. And this passage is saying that Jesus is the image or the visible manifestation of the invisible God, who is Yahweh God himself from the Old Testament. Jesus is God Almighty himself. That word for image right there is the Greek word 1504, icon, which means an image, a figure, a likeness. According to Strong's, it means a likeness, a statue, a profile, a representation, a resemblance, or an image. In other words, when you see Jesus Christ, you are looking at and watching and seeing Yahweh God of Israel in a human body. Look at what it says in Colossians chapter 2, verse 9. For in him, and that's speaking about Jesus again, for in Jesus dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, in Jesus. You are complete in Jesus, which is the head of all principality and power. In other words, this is another scripture that is emphatically saying that Jesus Christ is none other than Yahweh God in a human body, because the fullness of the Godhead bodily dwells in Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ has and is the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And I've heard it said like this, when you see God's body, it's because you're going to be looking at Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ is the bodily form of Yahweh God of Israel. For it pleased the Father that in Him, in Jesus, it pleased the Father that in Jesus should all fullness dwell. Now, the reason this is important is because this goes back to what we already talked about in John chapter 1, that in the beginning was the Word, the Logos, and the Logos was with God, and then the Logos became God. Because in the mind of God, before He ever started, in the Alpha, before it became the Omega, before He did a single thing, the plan was in His mind, and everything that was made was in His mind. Any Old Testament way of being saved were shadows of what He was going to do in Jesus Christ. And therefore, that's why I say that the plan of salvation is in Jesus Christ, and anything and everything has been leading up to the culmination and the grand finale that is in Jesus Christ, because Jesus Christ is Yahweh God manifested in a human body. I know I'm saying that a lot, but it's because I want you to absolutely get and understand that Jesus Christ is God manifest in the flesh, like we're about to see in a few scriptures. Stick with me, hang on. But looking at John chapter 14, verse 8, Philip saith unto him, Lord, and he's talking to Jesus, Philip saith unto Jesus, Lord, show us the Father, and it will sufficeth us, or satisfy us. Jesus saith unto him, have I been so long time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? Listen to this. He that has seen me, who? Jesus. He that has seen me has seen the Father, and how sayest thou then, show us the Father? In other words, Jesus was saying, look, Philip, you want me to show you the Father. Are you telling me that I've been with you all this time and you still haven't known or recognized me? Because if you've seen me, Jesus, if you have seen me, then you've seen the Father. So how can you ask me to show you the Father when the Father is standing here talking to you right here in front of you? And one of my most favorite verses in all the Bible, in 1 Timothy 3:16, listen to this. This is so powerful. And it says, and without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. Listen to this. God was manifest in the flesh. Did you hear that? God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the Spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into the glory. But listen to that. God was manifest in the flesh. Who was manifest in the flesh? Yahweh, God of Israel, God from the Old Testament. Why? Because the Logos got a body. Genomite. He got a body. And in fact, most of you know that the name of God Almighty in the Old Testament, I've been saying it here, but the name of God Almighty in the Old Testament was Jehovah or Yahweh. He said, I am. When you look in Exodus chapter 3, verse 13, it says, and Moses said unto God, behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, and I shall say unto them, the God of your fathers has sent me unto you, and they shall say unto me, what is His name? What shall I say unto them? And God said unto Moses, I am that I am. And He said, thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, I am has sent you. In other words, the way that God gave Moses to identify him by was, I want you to go tell everybody, I am has sent me. The reason that's important is because this emphatically ties in to what Jesus Christ Himself said, and Jesus cannot lie, or He cannot be sinless on the cross. Therefore, Jesus cannot be a liar. But listen to what He said in John chapter 8, starting at verse 56. He said, your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. That's going to be important. Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. That's Jesus talking. And Jesus said, Abraham saw my day and he was glad. Let's go on. Then said the Jews unto him, thou art not yet 50 years old, and hast thou seen Abraham? Listen to what Jesus said in verse 58. Jesus said unto him, verily, verily, truly, truly, I say unto you, before Abraham was, I am. They took up stones to cast at him, but Jesus hid himself and went out of the temple, going through the midst of them, and so passed by. Now, if you're an English reader and you don't know exactly what's going on in those old days and times, you might miss the importance of what just happened. Jesus Christ just said, before Abraham was, I am. And they picked up stones to stone him. That's very important, because the people that heard him, the listening ears that heard him right there, knew that Jesus Christ was saying that he was none other than Yahweh God himself. And that's why they picked up the stones to stone him, because they were going to stone him for blasphemy for saying that he was Yahweh God. Otherwise, there's no need to stone him. They picked up stones to stone him because they realized that Jesus just said, I am. And the reason that this is important is because this ties in to what Moses had just learned from the Lord. I want you to know that my name is I am. And now Jesus Christ is standing here telling them, I am. Why? Because he is saying that I am Yahweh God in this human vessel, in this human jar of clay, in this human body of flesh. I am Yahweh God of Israel. Now, I don't want to take the time to bog down in it, but Jesus said right there, he said, Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad. What was Jesus even talking about? What did he even mean? When you go to Genesis chapter 22, verse 8, and Abraham said, my son, God will provide himself a lamb for a burnt offering. That was the revelation that Abraham had, that God would provide himself. Did you get that? Himself a lamb. Not he's going to get a lamb, but that God himself will be the lamb of the burnt offering. In other words, the revelation that Abraham had was that God himself would be the sacrifice, would be the offering that was going to be presented. God didn't have to go get a sacrifice from somewhere, an offering from somewhere, because God himself would be the sacrifice. I want to show you something beautiful. Looking in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, and it says, for unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder. And listen to this, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Did you hear that? There's going to be a child born, there's going to be a son given, and his name shall be called the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father. When that child is born and that son is given, it will be none other than the Mighty God himself. When that child is born and son is given, it's going to be none other than the Everlasting Father himself. Why? Because the Logos, the concept, the idea, the plan was in the mind of God from the very beginning. And then when Jesus Christ was born of a Virgin Mary, it's because God got himself a body, and it was going to be called Emmanuel, God with us. In Matthew chapter 1, verse 23, it says, behold, a virgin shall be with child and shall bring forth a son. There it is. It ties in from Isaiah 9 and 6. Shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, being interpreted is God with us. Because Emmanuel means God with us. Why? Because Jesus Christ is literally God himself in a human body. When God Almighty came in the body of Jesus Christ, you are seeing the plan of God manifested that he had from the very beginning, the ultimate plan of salvation that everything else was leading up to, and all these other things were only a shadow pointing to, as God Almighty in Jesus Christ going to the cross and dying for our sins on our behalf, that we might be baptized in his name and resurrected unto him, filled with his spirit, and therefore we can be in heaven with him, because he is the ultimate plan of salvation, because as the plan of salvation, he is the way, the truth, and the life, and no man can come unto the Father, or in other words, go to heaven. Nobody can come unto the Father but through the plan of salvation that is Jesus Christ, who is the Logos from the very beginning, and then the Logos that became Jesus Christ, Genemai, the Word became flesh. Amen. But let me get back to John chapter 1 for just a moment, and let me reread it again. In the beginning was the Logos, or the Word, or the plan. In the beginning was the plan, and the plan was with God, and the plan was God. The plan was in the beginning with God. All things were made by the plan, and without the plan was not anything made that was made. That's very beautiful and very important, because I want to read Colossians chapter 1, verse 15, 16, and 17, speaking about Jesus. It says, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature, for by him. By what? by him, by Jesus. In other words, by the plan. For by the plan were all things created. In other words, everything that was ever created was made with the plan of salvation through Jesus Christ in mind, that are in heaven, that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by the plan and for the plan. And he, the plan, is before all things, and by the plan all things consist. This is incredible and beautiful and powerful, because this is saying not a single thing was created in heaven or in earth without the plan of God in mind, and everything that was created and held together was by the plan of God in Jesus Christ Almighty. This passage is not saying that Jesus Christ is another person separate and apart from God the Father Almighty. And this is not saying that Jesus Christ was standing there making all the stars, and he made Lucifer, and he made the planet, and he made all the solar system, and he didn't make Adam and Eve and everything in it. What this passage is actually saying is that everything that was made with the plan of salvation in mind. God already knew that Adam and Eve were going to fall and fail in the Garden of Eden. God already knew that humanity was going to mess up and fail. And that's one of the beautiful things that this is saying, is that God already knew the end from the beginning, and that he was going to redeem humanity and mankind, and he's been making a way to redeem and save mankind from the very beginning all the way to the ending. And this whole thing has been about his architect, his engineer, his beauty, his thought, his plan, his idea, his concept. And when it manifested, it's none other than the God who started the whole thing in the first place. This is absolutely incredible and amazing. Listen to Hebrews chapter 1 verse 2, because it says the same thing. Hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, by Jesus Christ, whom he hath appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. This is not saying that Jesus Christ is standing out there creating Jupiter and Mars and Pluto and all the planets. It's saying that everything that was made with the plan of salvation through Jesus Christ in mind. And I love John 14 and 6 so much. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. The only way you're going to get to the Father is through Jesus Christ, who is the plan of salvation. Now, skipping ahead, something else that I've got to show you that is going to be absolutely incredible and beautiful. Please listen to me. John chapter 1, starting at verse 12. I just want to hit these to get to verse 14. It says in verse 12, but as many as received the plan, to them the plan gave power to become sons of God, even to them that believe on the plan's name. That name is Jesus. Verse 13, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. Listen to verse 14. And the plan was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld the plan's glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. I already covered that that word was is the Greek word 1096, genomai, which means to come into existence or to come into being. In other words, the plan was made flesh at this moment that he's talking about right here. Now, the beautiful thing that I want to show you is that Greek word for dwelt right there is the Greek word 4637 skenio, which means a tent or an abode. To encamp or pitch a tent. In the New Testament, it is used to dwell in tents or to tabernacle. In fact, the Tree of Life version renders it like this. And the Word became flesh and tabernacled among us. In other words, the Word, the Logos, got a human body and tabernacled or dwelt in a human body among us. When did that happen? The Bible gives us the answer. It happened in Galatians chapter 4, verse 4. The Apostle Paul said, but when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth his Son, the plan, sent forth his Son, made of a woman, made under the law. He said, when the fullness of time was come, God sent forth the plan, the Logos, made of a woman, made under the law. Why? Because the plan of salvation is now manifested, and that is manifested in the body of Jesus Christ. Listen to what the Bible says in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, speaking about the seed of the woman who would come, because that ties into the other verses that we already covered. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed, and it shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Who? That's talking about Jesus, God manifested in the flesh, the plan of salvation, the way, the truth, and the life. In 1 John 1 and 1, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon, and our hands have handled of the word of life. What was he saying? The word, the Logos, that was in the beginning, we have heard with our ears, we have seen with our eyes, we have looked upon and touched, is none other than Jesus Christ himself. And I think it's beautiful, but listen to Revelation chapter 13, verse 8. And all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him whose names are not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Why? That passage is not saying that there is another person or a part of the Trinity that's separate and apart from God the Father, and it's not saying that there is a body or an existing spirit that is Jesus Christ separate from God Almighty. It's simply saying that the Lamb of God was slain from the foundation of the world because the plan of God was with God in the beginning before God ever started. And I got to read 1 Timothy 3:16 again because I love it so much. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. I love that so much because it simply sums it up right there and says, God was manifested in the flesh. And another thing that you have to absolutely know and understand is that the Bible says that you could only worship God himself. Yet when Jesus Christ is born, the Bible says that the angels were commanded to worship Jesus Christ. And there was a time and place where a person was healed of Jesus Christ, and that person began to worship him, and Jesus did not refuse the worship that that person gave him. Why? Because it was not illegal. It was not a breaking of the law. It was not a sin for anyone to worship Jesus Christ, because when they worshiped Jesus Christ, they were actually worshiping Yahweh, God of Israel. I want to give you peace of mind and know something today. There's some people that I talk to that they feel like that they have to pray for 20 minutes to the Father. They feel like they have to pray 20 minutes to the Son, and they feel like they have to pray 20 minutes to the Holy Spirit because they don't want to make any of them mad because they feel like they're all separate and different. Well, I want you to know that Jesus Christ is none other than Yahweh God himself living in a human body. And the Greek word logos is specifically stating that over and over, that in the beginning was the logos, the thought or idea or plan that he had of how he was going to save all of humanity because he knew we were going to fail and fall down and we would need to be redeemed. And in the beginning was the plan, and the plan was with God, and then the plan was God when the fullness of time was come, and then the invisible God got an image, and the image that he got, or the superscription, or the resemblance of God Almighty, was none other than Jesus Christ. Therefore, when you see Jesus Christ, you see Yahweh God of Israel living in and dealing with a human body and going through life as a human body, ultimately dying on the cross, because Jesus Christ is Yahweh God of Israel in a human body as the plan of salvation of how he's going to redeem mankind. Therefore, Jesus Christ is the ultimate revelation and glory that God is going to get unto himself because it is none other than God himself in a human body. Amen. God bless you. I hope this video was a blessing to you. I know I went over that maybe a little bit too much for you, and I repeated myself over and over, but it's because I want you to know and understand that the Logos is none other than God Almighty manifested in flesh. Because the Bible says that Jesus specifically had a beginning moment, genomai, the word that existed in the beginning as Logos, a plan or an idea or a concept in the mind of God, had a beginning when Jesus Christ was born of a virgin and God Almighty got himself a human body and lived through that human body. Therefore, just like Philip, if you ask Jesus Christ, Jesus, please show me the Father and it will satisfy me and make me happy, Jesus Christ would have to look at you just like he did Philip and said, what do you mean? You want me to show you the Father? Have I been with you all this time, talking to you, dialoguing to you, showing you these signs, wonders, and miracles, and doing all of these things, and you haven't come to the grasp and realization that I am none other than Yahweh God Almighty living in a human body? So how can I show you the Father if you don't grasp and understand that I am indeed the Father? It also understands and explains why they took up stones to stone Jesus and kill him for blasphemy. blasphemy when Jesus Christ himself said, I am, because Jesus was saying that I am none other than Yahweh God of Israel, who was talking to Moses in the burning bush and saying, I am, go tell your children, the people of Israel, your brothers and sisters, that Yahweh, Jehovah, has sent you. And then Jesus Christ said, I am, and they took up stones to stone him because Jesus was saying, I'm Yahweh in a human body. And it also explains 1 Timothy 3:16, which says God was manifest in the flesh because God got himself a fleshly body when the fullness of times was come, when it pleased the Father that in Jesus should all the fullness of the Godhead bodily dwell in Jesus Christ, the body of human flesh that was the tabernacle or the tent that the Spirit of God Almighty was dwelling in, so that he could be the way, the truth, and the life. And there's no other name given among men whereby we must be saved other than the name of Jesus Christ. And every knee is going to bow and every tongue is going to confess that Jesus Christ is the Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Why? Because God's going to receive the most ultimate and wonderful glory through the revelation of the plan of salvation that is in Jesus Christ. And that's why I cannot leave without telling you that you need to get baptized in Jesus' name for the remission of sins, just like they tell you in Acts chapter 2, verse 38, and just like everybody was baptized in the book of Acts. And not only that, but you need to get filled with the Holy Ghost, evidenced by speaking in tongues, just like Acts chapter 2, verse 38 tells you. And just like through the whole book of Acts, the Jews were filled with the Holy Ghost, the Samaritans were filled with the Holy Ghost, and the Gentiles were filled with the Holy Ghost, and you need to be filled with the Holy Ghost too. I want to remind you that I got lots of videos on my YouTube channel. I've got lots of videos about being baptized in Jesus' name and lots of videos about being filled with the Holy Ghost. But I want to tell you, get filled with the Holy Ghost, evidenced by speaking in tongues, and get baptized in the name of Jesus Christ, because there's remission of sins in no other name under heaven whereby you must be saved. God bless you. I love you. I appreciate you. And I can't wait to see you in the next one. Until next time, you pray for me and I'll be praying for you. I love you. God bless you. And I'll see you in the next one. Bye-bye.